Nice afternoon. I hope I have half an hour. Very interesting for you. Thanks, Richard, for the introduction. So it's Vision for Robotics. So basically, we try to make robots see. That means particularly see objects. So we are mainly concerned with whatever has to do with the like stable structure in the world, objects, structures, furniture, and so on. We use 2D and 3D vision methods for modeling, tracking, recognition, classifying, and finally grasping and handling objects. And ideally, we would like to understand the form and function of objects and teach the robot what to do with these objects. And today, I will give an overview of what we are doing. And the main important thing is that, yes, we use a lot of computer vision methods, but we specifically then use them from the robotic system view. So the assumption is always that the robot is operating in an environment and typically repeatedly. So the robot with time will acquire some knowledge about its environment. So, you know, you can assume it has a map. It knows where rooms are. It knows where typically the structures are. It knows the typical objects in that environment. And that's what we would like to know and make work. Also, typically the task is known. So, you know, bring an object. So that means searching for the object, grasping it, placing it somewhere. And of course, you can't bring a specific mug if you don't know anything about the specific mug, if you have never seen it before. So you need to know something about the object, and that's where models come into play. So I will show a bit what we're doing with models. This is kind of an overview. Actually, do you see the mouse?
Yes,
do you see the mouse now?
Yes, perfect.
Okay, so that's one of our robots. That's the Hobbit robot. It was with older people at home. You see here kind of one of the idea was that old people living alone at home, one of the things is that they should not fall, so we pick up everything from the floor. Yeah, it's I will come to that later on how we do it. We don't even have to recognize what it is, but we basically need to grasp it and then put it in the tray of the robot. And of course, it did some other things too, but I will come to that later. But the robot driving around in the home means that we have some 3D perception. So you not only need 2D perception, like with a laser, you really need the 3D full understanding. And yes, you can use the floor for navigation and localization. But then we're actually interested in the objects, and some of the things, for example, get relatively easy. Once you have the floor, detecting chairs is relatively easy because they're just next to the floor. That's most likely one of the first things you're going to see. And chairs typically have a very clear, particularly 3D structure. So it's relatively easy to do that as depicted here. And then, of course, we go further. We know the surface, so we know all the other horizontal planes where typically object stands. So we can extract the planes and then the object clusters on top where we create hypotheses and then only recognize the objects, which is a process that is much easier than you just have the image. And then in the image, without any further context knowledge, you just try to detect whatever there is. So I try to step you through some of the things we developed recently. So one of the first things is the object map. Basically, what we want to create is kind of like a reference map, and you see it's fully 3D. That was from a project where we were actually, this is a small kindergarten room, where we wanted to make order with the robot and kids in kind of a game. And here you see the present situation as compared to the reference. So you see the clusters indicated where we found there are objects in the world. And yeah, of course, you can play around with methods that cover the full room with as few screenshots as possible. So every one of these cones is basically a Kinect image. And you see that the reachability is not very far because the resolution of this all this RGBD sensor drops very quickly, and we have no good detection results, so we don't use them much beyond 2 meters. One of the next steps is then to identify the certain structures, so chairs, tables, floor walls, and so on. This is the ground truth of some of the images. And that's typically what we find out at the moment. So it's pretty reasonable. One of the problems with all these approaches, and it's not only us, but basically all computer vision approaches, is they're pixel-wise. So they don't have this object understanding that we have. To show you what I mean, so you go around the room and you assemble basically many pictures and you attribute pixel by pixel classes to objects. So you see that the sofa typically gets two sofa and bed labels, which yes are related but not the same, so you would need to decide at one point. Even more ridiculous is actually the table, yeah, because it has four different colors, indicating like it's four different objects, and that's actually not very useful. So at the moment, many groups are trying to work on how to get from pixel-based to object-based semantic labeling. And that turns out to be not that easy, first because you need to merge many views. So this is quite a lot of views that have been merged here. And then all the views indicate different things. So you need to make up your mind basically what it is. You see, for example, the chair is lying here. So that's on purpose, so that we see that, you know, the chair even in another orientation is also detected. And in that case, actually, the chair is detected very well. And then back to this tidy up scenario. Of course, tidy up means you need to have a reference. Yeah, so basically, you start with your reference and then you go back in the room and you want to check what is different. And you could expect that things like the keyboard is still there, but it moved a bit. Yeah, which would be a classical thing to do, because it's not going to be always at the same, very same location. So you need to recognize it, understand that this is the the semantic segmentation, understand it's a keyboard and it just moved. It's more or less at the same location, while some other objects completely moved. And of course, there are all the cases like an object came or is gone, so disappeared or reappeared, or for example, it has been moved from A to B within the visible area. So that's then the cases we keep track of. One of the important things for that is also attention, where we also use depths. So the classical image-based method is not good because it's 2D. It would take very dark or bright regions also as an attention region, but that's actually not interested. So we played around a lot with depths, and depths clearly indicates, you know, like what is on top. The top objects, and then we can segment much better from these top regions. And here are some examples where we clearly can show that we get better segmentations than the rest for all these nice scenes. To show you examples on how we do that in the Kinect image, here is a video, because that better shows everything in 3D. So we are extracting planar and curved object segments. They're then grouped together. So here are some curved ones. You see them. You see, for example, for the bowl, that there's quite some, you know, shape in between where we have no data points. But because of the convexity of the object, it's rather clear what should belong together. For the boxes, it's relatively easy because whenever there is convexity, you can basically group the surfaces together. Even if you don't see the backsides, you see the fronts and you can clearly make objects out of them. If you recognize them, you just make them complete 3D models. Otherwise, you have just the planes combined. And yeah, to tell you what has been grouped together, we're just artificially moving the segments, and you see that this works relatively nicely. If this doesn't work, you could go into the scene and touch objects. So sometimes the clutter is too heavy. And for example, here we have a scenario where objects have not been separated by the segmentation algorithm due to whatever error they have been grouped together. And then we check quasi for convexity of that region and create hypotheses which of the regions is better to separate. We go in with the robot arm, try to move that cluster, and now separated these two objects. It's still not perfect. They're still a bit reddish on the box, actually, but at least it found its kind of two objects. Segmentation is still not perfect, so the motion was not enough. But that's a useful thing in more cluttered scenes to get a nice separation if the method itself does not do that. So I told you about object modeling. One of the things we are doing, and the software is free, is RTMT. It's recognition tracking at the modeling toolbox. I show you better how it works. So the idea is that you take some textured background. Yeah, so that's just some textured background. You put the object on top, and then you rotate it. We take this planar surface that we have as the support plane, and whatever is on top of it, we use as model. So the model itself can be uniform, doesn't need any texture, because we just take whatever is on top. We create a full 6D model, as shown here. It's a point cloud that is textured and has actually edges and has interest points, so whatever you want to do with vision processing, because we have all the images. And then you can use this model for object recognition, or in this case where we show the example, it's actually used for tracking. So we know a 6D model, we know the edges of the object. In this case, we are only using the color image, so it does not need depth. You see the coordinate system that indicates that we have the exact pose of the object. You see that the occlusion is pretty good. We can turn it around 360 degrees. Still works. And yes, you can do quite some scale changes. Although I have to admit that back there, if you would rotate it, the object is too small, so then we would fail. But if you nicely put it back with translation, that's okay. To indicate the models and how they look like, so they look reasonably well if you have texture on top of them. If you take away the texture, you really see what the kinect sensor can do. So here you see the typical ripple. Yeah, here for example. So without any additional fitting, that's just basically the remainder of the uncertainty or resolution of the kinect. It won't get much better. You also see that, for example, the lever here, you get part of it. And of course, the Lego car, the small dots of Lego are just too small for the resolution the camera has at the moment. But in principle, we should be able to do that. So whenever we get better sensors, we could get better models. Also notice, for example, this is the T-box. So it's a cardboard box with rather clear edges. The typical effect of Kinect is that you get kind of rounded edges. Yeah, and you see that nicely here. That's a very classical effect that the Kinect is doing. And yeah, the texture model as we have it here. So the texture model can use with interest points for object recognition. That's an example we had actually in the kindergarten scenario with several of the objects there. And we wanted to test it in our kitchen with the classical objects. So in robotics, there's a data set. With 51 classes, that's the data set by Lai in Seattle, Washington. They have created a robot data set where they made very good images of all these objects, so it's 51 object classes. We distributed them in our kitchen and we wanted to see how good that's going to work. Not when they're single standing objects, but how does it work when objects are in clutter, so in a more realistic scene. And our findings were quite interesting. So we tested 5 different CNN implementations. We tested on 3 databases. So ARID is our own database. This is like what I showed here, the database. And there are 2 other databases. One is the data set by Lai. That's this robot data set. Basically, it's only one object alone. Of course, it's very good. You see the red images here. And then we created the web data set, you know, just finding web images. Also there, it worked very well. But again, objects were more or less single standing and centered. And you see already that for robotics scenarios, you know, detection rates are like half, 40% less. So, you know, that's drastic. What turned out to be the case is viewpoint. Viewpoint changes are much more drastic from the robot. Object size is very important. Of course, we have occlusion and clutter. and there is no understanding of the situation. So if we test on robot images, we need to bring into account this context. So for example, objects standing on planes would help a lot, because then we get real clusters where should be object, and that primes that they recognize us. And another problem is actually learning takes a lot, because 51 classes with 1,000 images each is not what you expect, and adding a new object would not really be easy. It takes quite a lot of learning time. So that's the topics I will discuss next. Also, we saw that this is a difficult problem, so we wanted to create a larger data set, and we have now, it's publicly available, OSIP, the Object Clutter Indoor data set. And that's how the scenes look like, so you really have clutter. And basically, oh, sorry, I thought I have a video here, but I don't. So the idea is that we do not, you know, if you present the full system with the full clutter scene, the question is how you get ground truth for every pixel of the object. And the idea we have is that, yes, the camera is fixed, but we introduce one object after the next. And with one step after the next, you automatically get the exact pixel map. And the pixel map is very helpful, because then you can do basically the learning automatically. And also all the benchmarking can be done automatically, because I have bounding boxes, I have pixel maps, I have masks, I have the complete 3D representation, I have all the data from ground truth available that I would want. And then I can employ whatever method I have and test on this data set. So we use this for one of the methods where we created CAD models and learned from CAD models from the web only. We created artificial views so that all the views that we have here are represented. And the specific thing now is that you get this image with about 2 images per second. We extract the background plane, so that's a Kinect image. You see that the ripple is much worse back there, because that's the resolution of the Kinect. Then we extract that point cloud, and then for the point cloud we want to see what object it is. Remember that we compare that specific object that we see here, the hammer for example, with a database of CAD models. So we have never seen this specific Tetra bug, but we have seen only CAD models. But still, that works very nicely, because the shape of only that cluster is very similar. The big wings don't play a role here. As you see, we still find that it's an aeroplane. It's relatively easy to see. Yeah, you saw the shark was not easy, and this rolling pin doesn't work at all. So it doesn't work for all objects, and also the mug, toilet paper roll, this class distinction doesn't work perfectly. And we are working on improving this. So one of the methods that we try to use is, so this I hope shows you the problem. So typically, if you have a robot view, you only see the front view. You will not see the back part. So you don't see the underside. You don't see the backside. So remember, this is the full 3D model. Yeah. So if you try to match these two, it's no way you get a good match, because the maximum match you can get is like 30 to 40%. Yeah, you will never get like the underside, the backside, the back legs, and so on. Yeah. So that's a problem. So all your direct matchings will be bad. So what we do is, that's why we create these artificial views that are shown here. Yeah, because then we have a better matching. Yes, we have to match against more views, but still it's a better match. And the second thing is, we try to have clusters of parts. So that's the table plane and the leg. As long as we can somehow cluster them together, it's fine. And then we can use them separately. And you see that our approach outperforms some others. And yes, scale helps, so that without scale, it's a bit less. So in this case, scale helps a bit. The most recent approach is Pix2Pose. So that's from a data set, not from my group, but from another group. We use Pix2Pose learning the pose estimation. And you see here these cubes represent the correct pose. So green is the baseline. Blue is what we recognize, and you see it's pretty good. You see, for example, for this watering can, it's a rotationally symmetric object. So you see that there's a slight deviation in angle because you don't see the tip. It's occluded behind that object. If you look at the other objects here, the rotation is not so critical. So for example, here for that bottle, it's a flat bottle. So, you know, the surface is used, so the orientation is pretty good. That method of pose estimation was very good. We won two of the challenges in the BOP challenge, so the object pose challenge at ICCB last year. YCB is the Yale, Carnegie, Berkeley dataset, and Amazon dataset is for object picking from shelves. For learning from CAD data, we found that synthetic data is very good, but you need to render data that kind of covers the domain of the object. So if you have objects like in this real domain, you want to create by rendering and data augmentation scenes that are similar to the scenes that I finally tested on. That's important because it seems all these learning networks take up some of the context. So if there's background like from planes, it seems the methods also use that context, at least implicitly, we don't know explicitly, and that improves the results. That's yet another method where we use templates. That's only for 2D objects. One of the ideas was here that we want to have as few object showings as possible. So again, we use objects dropped in a simulator, creating ground truth. It's a simulation, so we know completely how the objects look like. We have these masks or 2D templates. And from the templates, only 16 or 20 of them, we can actually find if the object is in reality in that pose, position and orientation. And you see we get quite nice results. Only learning from CAD data, so never having seen that object before. Finally, all these methods that I showed here, yeah, starting from actually this method, and all these methods here, typically what they do is they give me a hypothesis that this object is in this location.
To verify that this is really true, or how accurate that is, or if it might be correct or not, it's good to do another processing step. And we call it the hypothesis verification step.
So after the categorization or the detection,
we do this verification step. What are we doing? Remember that when we get a detection here, yeah, for example, from here, from this example, what you get is you get the class of the object, the model that has been used, I mean, for learning, so that's the 2D model, the 3D CAD model, and you get the pose hypothesis. So what's the orientation in the hypothesis of the detection? And I can use this now and merge that with my data that I have here and do something like a verification step. So typically what is done is something like ICP, and either it converges or not, but definitely it gives me a measure on how well the data fits to my model. So I showed you before that toilet paper is not working that well. You see an example here. So for example, toilet paper was first actually estimated as a bowl with 39%, mug with 29%, and toilet paper only 25%. So we know already from the ranking, we know one thing. So the ranking already tells us that the system is not very sure. Compared to here, the system says immediately bowl 100%, or even here for the market says 71%. Yeah, so if you get 39 as the topmost, you know already the system is not very certain. The second thing is typically the gap between the first two or first three tells you how clear the system is. So if the gap is like small, like here, it's already an indication that the system is not very certain about it, and it makes sense to verify. And you see that after the verification step with the first hypothesis, it's very clear though this is toilet paper, and we have actually confirmed the pose of the object in the scene, which is now then input for the robot to grasp it. Okay, so this has been single standing objects. I would claim that objects that are standing alone on the table, and if I know the class of the object or the specific instance, in my opinion, this is a solved case. I mean, yes, I need to train the systems for novel objects, but basically I would claim this is solved. Yes, you can do that. You can segment out objects if they're single standing. What we are really working on at the moment is what happens if you have a kitchen scene like this, which is expected to be rather the case, particularly in my kitchen or in our office kitchen, for example, and then it becomes a bit more difficult. Again, what we do is we do a hypothesis verification. What we actually do is we run all the object classifiers and instance recognizers that we have. We create a bunch of hypotheses. You see here, this is big chaos. We actually also estimate the ground plane. Yeah, so that's that the ground plane is also, or the supporting plane is also a hypothesis. And then we run all hypotheses simultaneously in a global model and try to explain the scene as good as possible. What we're actually doing is we are maximizing the inliers. We try to explain every data point only with one model. So if you have the, so that's another application from the reference paper. So you see that stupid second object here. So that means that you explain some data twice. I mean, that's not possible. I mean, a data point can only belong to one object. Yeah, so we penalize duplicate points. Of course, we want at least model outliers as possible. And another thing we do is if you have smooth surfaces where there's like no edges in between, this should be explained by one object only. So for example, the explanation we have here is pretty stupid because that's a smooth cluster. It can't be that this is like an object like this. Yes, of course, you can have situations where like two boxes touch immediately and perfectly, and then you see very little line in between, but that's the really rare cases. So normally that's not the case. And that's how it's running. It's actually on a laptop in real time, so you see it's reasonably fast for a real scene. Observe here, for example, this has been the first hypothesis. The handle is not explained. Now the handle is explained. Actually, then we find the pose that is even better. Now it has been just shifted a bit. And with time, all the objects come here. We have all the objects identified except one here. This one is too much occluded, so we will never find it. We know that there are some data points there that are not explained, but most likely we would have to take away the object in front of it to be able to really detect and recognize it. But otherwise, that's a very good explanation of a rather complex scene. So that's one of the best works we have at the moment for explaining cluttered scenes. Finally, object function. Again, we start from the model. Using the model, you can do some estimation. So for example, liquid containment. If the object is complete, so there's no holes, you can estimate that for a certain orientation, it contains a liquid. So for example, if the mug is lying down, it's not a liquid container, it's just a container. You can put something other inside, but you can definitely not put liquid inside. If it's upside down, it has a planar surface on top, so you can put something on top. Yes, that would be possible for the rim, but we don't have modeled that yet. We can train categorizers for these affordances, which means that we identify if it's stackable or unstable in this case, or it has liquid containment, and then we can put it to the robot. That's our Romeo robot. We put a glass in front of it, so the robot is not recognizing the glass. Glass is a problem, only plastic actually. But glass is really a big problem. We hardly see that. So basically, the robot grabs what we put into his hand, but then it recognizes this is the only container that we have, and it pours the. Oh God. That's something wrong with the video here. It should show more on the left side. So it pours the paper clips actually in there. None of our robots is waterproof, so no water next to robots, it's only paper. Finally, something about grasping. So I guess you can imagine that we can grasp everything if we have completely modeled and recognized objects. The more interesting thing is actually situations like this where recognition is difficult. So what we do here, we grasp into the pile and we grasp everything that we leave is a good grasping point. So whatever fits into the shape of the hand. You see that sometimes the robot makes a bit weird motions, but that's the motion planning. Here, for example, very weird motion to approach the object. But what can we do? That's motion planning. That's out of our expertise. But otherwise, we have nice separation of objects. And once objects are separated, it's much easier to recognize them. That method does not really understand what it's doing. So sometimes it's just taking two objects, like this case, because it has no understanding. It just found a good grasping point, and of course, that's what it's doing. And we used actually this method in this Hobbit project where I was talking about in the very beginning. So the idea was to support old people at home. One of the ideas was fall prevention, so that's why picking up everything from the floor. But another important thing is you want to keep the old people as active as possible. So you do not want them to become inactive. So we saw that, we called it mutual care, because the humans had to take care of the robot, for example, opening doors, but also like a dog or other pet, they had to do something for the robot. So they had some responsibility. So the robot came like a dog would come every 3 hours to the user and said, you know, play something with me, do something, make your exercises, play a game and things like that. And one of the things was picking up from the floor. So that's one of the older persons at home. Actually, the nephew allowed us, gave us that video, and the grandpa and the nephew allowed us to use the video. So the robot drives there, looks down, extracts again the flat surface. There's something sticking out of the surface. We grasp whatever sticks out of the surface. In this case, we are not recognizing. Now the robot is looking back. It's not on the surface anymore. So we believe we have it in the finger. There's no sensors in the finger. And we put it on the tray. That turned out to be the most robust behavior for the robot. And that's our new version of Hobbit. It's called Sasha. It's actually the Toyota HSR human support robot in our lab. It is much smaller than the old Hobbit, which is good because that's important for bringing it in user homes. You see that we recognize all the objects on the tables here. We have the annotations with what it is and the poses. You saw here the recognition. Unfortunately, once the object is grasped, it's not shown anymore. So here you see the grasp poses, including the approach pose. The approach pose is a bit higher, and then the robot has to go down. We do that also because then the motion planning is much easier. Once the object is lifted, it kind of disappears because it was lifted and it's not recognized anymore. And yeah, you see here all the understanding what we have. So we have the understanding of there's the table, there's the background, with some noise in point cloud on the edges. So that's what the robot sees. And we have a full simulation. And I think that's very important because that makes it much easier for us to basically debug the robot. So that's another object. Again, grasping it. Taking it, so that's the view from the robot. You see that at the point of taking, the camera is completely occluded by the arm, so we don't see it. That's the side camera from before, so that's the top camera from before. And that's, of course, not valid anymore. Okay, and with this, I come to an end. I tried to introduce the vision for robotics lab. So you saw we do a lot with objects. Modeling, tracking, recognition, classification, and of course, always with the end goal for robot grasping and handling of objects. We built up this Hobbit robot for tidying up. We are working, for example, for a company called Aeolus Robotics in Vienna. which is a Taiwanese company with the goal to go into homes, care facilities, and do useful tasks. We worked for a fire brigade robot. Taurop is another company in Vienna, where we worked for EADS. One of the most recent projects is that we will start in January is sterile medical products assembly. Again, there we need to know everything about objects, the pose, and particularly the understanding of form or function. So we need to test for every assembly that we do if it was done correctly. So you clip two objects together, then you shake them as a checking function if they have been done correctly. And with this, thank you for your attention, and I'm open for questions.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I encourage people to ask questions in chat, but no question appears except my own. But please feel free to ask. You can unmute your microphone and ask immediately, or you can put your question in the chat. I in the meantime, I will read one of my questions. When detecting the objects, containers, and so on, are you able also distinguish between the liquid container is full or empty?
Not visually. And with the robots, it depends on the robot. So with the KUKA arm, yes, we can, because it has a tactile feedback and force torque sensors. With the HSR, we cannot. So that's unfortunately not possible.
Nor for the colored liquids, because if you will color it, it will be distinguishable. But,
typically, we recognize the objects from the labels. So you would need a special learning phase where you learn the objects with like levels. Mm-hmm. We have actually done that in a specific project, one of these Taurop project. There was an Argos challenge as an oil company, and they wanted to know the liquid level. But there it was a very specific procedure where we looked like specifically at the bottle or at that glass container and looked how full it is. Mm-hmm. But that was a very specific procedure, so not like in the normal standing of where how objects are placed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Someone else want to ask something for this, I think, really interesting topics?
So you had another question, which is the position precision of recognized
objects. Yes, that was my question. I mean, whether the position distinction is so precise that you can directly navigate, for example, robot manipulator and grasp it, or no?
So we can. So the precision is depending on the Kinect or on the color image, and typically we know that best resolution is reached about a meter or maybe 1.5 meters. So we try to have exactly that range for recognition and pose estimation, and then we get about 0.5 centimeter of uncertainty, and that is typically enough for grasping. I mean, you have to open the grip a bit wider anyway.
Yeah, of course.
And then it's sufficient. Yes, of course. If you have, a downside is, imagine you have objects very close together, then we sometimes have problems. So not only the planner fails, but also the grasping then itself fails, because then we need to open the grip a bit further, and then we might collide with the neighboring objects or not do that. So clutter is definitely something everybody has to work on. I have recently seen a talk about planning where they wanted to grasp in a fridge. And yeah, this is like open research. I mean, it's really, really difficult with clutter in a shelf situation where you have the shelves additionally as obstacles.
Okay, I saw Michal Kovanec was raising hand, so please,
yeah.
Michal.
I would like to ask you which of presented model are you using currently? It is a ResNet or VGG?
ResNet. ResNet is one of our favorites. The advantage of ResNet is it's extremely robust. So whenever you teach it, I mean, you can be sure that it's good. Yeah, some colleagues try others like VGG and some. I think I showed what JB is using here for this path based. So he used point pair features which do very well. And then a graph convolution.
Yeah, that was my next question. Is there some details of graph convolutional neural network you used, or it is some proprietary?
No. It should be in that paper from Jean-Baptiste Weibel at ICA last year, if you don't locate it. And as far as I know, the code is, I mean, we are doing research and we have a lot of publicly funded projects, so the code should be publicly available. If you don't find it or there are any problems, you know, I will link you up with Jean-Baptiste and I'm sure there is no problem, you can use it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's what we always hope for. Code is available. Also, the pick-to-pose, which we're using a lot, pick-to-pose, also that is available. Mm. It's in GitHub.
And you are using PyTorch or something else?
Yes.
Oh, great. Thanks.
We just moved actually all our lecture from MATLAB to Python. So everybody is now using Python. It makes no sense to teach the students something that we are not using.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Next question is in the chat. Andre asked whether is the PointNet network now the best solution for processing point clouds by deep learning, or there is already something better?
So PointNet is very good, but we just mentioned the two. So actually, point pair features is still one of the best methods for object pose estimation. So exactly what I had here. Yeah, pick-to-pose uses this. That's the point pair features is still one of the best methods. And then we use pick-to-pose. So pick-to-pose, if you want, I can show you from another presentation, maybe how that works, because it's completely different. We basically color the 3D images and use quasi artificial colors as depth representation, but that is our standard that we use most at the moment. I need to check if it's in this presentation. Sorry. No. Where is it? I had it in a recent presentation somewhere. Git. Yeah, let's check out Git. So while I'm searching, maybe ask the next question.
And the next question, if somebody wants, feel free to add your questions to the chat, so it's easily found.
So here's a better description of pick-to-pose, or the idea of pick-to-pose. So we have a 3D representation. Somehow something this did not work. My computer is just dying, I think. So we have XYZ coordinates, but then we create basically an artificial color image out of that and use this for learning. And that's why it's called pick-to-pose, because we go from the pixel, or all the pixels, to position, to position and orientation of objects. And here we have the models. And what we specifically do is we treat symmetry. So, you know, these two poses are basically nearly identical, and all the networks have problems with that, because they basically see the same, but they're punished because the orientation is 180 degree different. Mm-hmm. And we use the model knowledge itself that this is similar, and use the what is called transformer loss. That paper was presented at ICCV last year. As I said, the code is in GitHub, so you can use it. And if there are questions, yeah, please feel free to ask me.
Mm-hmm. Next question by Michal Mali. In hypothesis verification step, do you use only point cloud or also the texture data?
For what I showed, we only use the point cloud. We use the texture only for hypothesis creation, but not for that check, because in the check we really want to match the 3D pose using basically ICP.
One question I have from the beginning is whether you test your methods also for not so good illumination condition in darker condition and maybe not so really high quality cameras and so on.
So we don't test for high quality cameras. We test only our cameras that we have on the robot. Because that's what you expect. So it's like the Kinect camera, the Kinect color camera. It's reasonable, or now it's the RealSense color camera and RealSense like depth images that we are using. But we have always reasonable illumination. If you go in dark environments, we know that it's not working well. Mm-hmm. I mean, not the shape. If the depth, you know, is because it's infrared projected illumination, it doesn't bother. But whenever you use color, it's not going to work well.
Mm-hmm. Next question.
Very good question from Adam.
Mm-hmm. Have you considered using laser scanners with higher precision, such as Photoneo, to obtain better ground truth data?
Excellent question. We are working exactly on that. So we have now a project where we want to test one of these Photoneo sensors, which I have seen at the fair from Photoneo. And we want to test one of them because they have definitely better resolution than all the other sensors we tested before. And they're definitely better than RealSense and the Kinect. Of course, they're a bit larger, but yeah, it's okay. I mean, there are some applications where you definitely need that. So we haven't tested it yet.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
It's me. It's Adam. But I assume the limitation is also the cost of such sensors. So you mentioned that you have those RealSense sensors, which would not be as expensive, right?
Yes, but that always depends on your application. So we have, for example, a project where we work for clearing clutter, quasi for a scenario in nuclear power plants where you have debris stuff flying around. Their cost is not an issue. Yeah, so it makes sense to have sensors that are much better and give you better data. If you want to put that on a home robot that we don't have yet anyway in large numbers, I mean, we have the Sasha robot, but that's like still a prototype. I mean, if they want to go somewhere, they need a cheaper sensor. So I think that always depends on the application.
Yeah.
I mean, we tested, for example, N-Sensor, which is an active stereo sensor. It's also very, very expensive. And we did not find that the data is much better than Kinect data. So actually, I'm looking forward to Photoneo because it's expensive. But what I have seen from the images, the quality of the depth data that I get is much better than from the stereo camera. So why should I buy the expensive stereo camera, but rather go for a laser sensor that gives me better data?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Anybody else wants to ask either by directly just unmute your microphone or put your question into the chat? Seems that nobody else want to ask something, so let me thanks again for a really interesting presentation. I think some people from here for sure will contact you with more detailed questions or offer for cooperation. And I hope that we will meet sometimes on the...
Yeah, I hope so too, really.
On the leaf lecture, not only online.
But I hope the situation will improve, and then it's very close by.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks, you everyone.
Thanks for everybody. Have a nice evening.
Goodbye.
Bye bye.
Goodbye.